Hi, welcome to another episode of This Is My Architecture. I'm David John, and I have with me Suryakant from TCS. Hi, Suryakant. Welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks for having me on the show.
So a lot of us know about TCS. Tell us something about TCS DNA platform.
TCS DNA stands for Digital Platform for Next Gen Agriculture. So this platform caters to the customers from agri-banking, agri-finance, and of course, to the farmers.
Wonderful. So we are here to discuss about geospatial data analysis done using your DNA platform. So can you let me know what are the use cases this architecture caters to?
Yeah, this platform currently covers around 329 million hectares of area, and it caters to around 20 use cases, which are related to crop area, crop health, the crop yield, and also about the soil moisture on the field level and the regional level.
So that's some fantastic set of use cases. Let's go a little bit deeper. So what are the data sources for this platform?
Yeah, so this platform uses four major data sources. The main data source that comes from the satellites is the open domain satellite data, which is provided by the space agencies like ISRO and the NASA. The another set of data set which is available on the AWS, which is also the open data, but it has been readily made available by AWS on the S3 buckets. Third set of data set that we have is the field level data set collected by the field managers and the field agents. And that data is also collected as a GIS data into the PostgreSQL.
So I see that the satellite data is being consumed, but in addition, you're also leveraging registry of open data on AWS. Why exactly is that?
Yeah, so the registry of open data on AWS has helped us to reduce the data transfer costs by providing the required number of spectral regions. For example, the satellite generally has the 13 spectral regions, but we use in our processing only the 4 spectral regions. And this registry of open data helps us to get only the required number of spectral regions, and it has reduced our data size from 60 terabytes to 20 terabytes. And we process this amount of data at interval of every 5 days to 10 days.
Wonderful, glad that it was useful. So what happens once the data is readily available?
So once the data is readily available, the lambda here, it actuates the processing jobs on the SageMaker. So 3,400 processing jobs are parallelly spun by this SageMaker. And these jobs take input from the registry of open data, the data set from the satellites, the GIS data set from the government agencies, including the field boundaries. And this data set is, again, after processing, the output is pushed back in the form of zonal statistics to the PostgreSQL GIS database. And also in the form of image, it is pushed back to the S3 bucket. And this data set acts as a output to the end user.
Right. So looks like the parallel executions of SageMaker processing jobs seems to have given you the spatial and temporal scalability, which was much required. So who actually consumes this process data?
Yeah, the users from agriculture sector consumes this data. The applications, the UI applications are deployed using the EKS, and which is obviously facilitated by the EC2 instances. The EKS, the data moves from EKS to the CloudFront through the geospatial data layers, and it is consumed by the user in the form of UI layers, and the users gets about the data. So for example, here one use case, which is around 10 GB of data, which has to be consumed by the user. So CloudFront helps us here to cache the data and provide it to the user very efficiently and effectively.
Good, glad to hear. So CloudFront gives you better user experience and also reduces your data transfer cost when the maps are being consumed by the user. So I'm interested to find out what were some key challenges you faced and how does this platform address them?
Yeah, the key challenges that we had here are in the form of scalability and the cost. So currently we are processing the data at a India scale. So we can easily increase our spatial scale from India to any other countries like Indonesia or Thailand. And also on the temporal side, we are currently processing the data at a five-day interval, and we can reduce that to even one-day interval. So similarly, on the cost part, the SageMaker, by parallelly spinning out the 3,400 processing jobs, has helped us to reduce our processing cost. And the registry of open data has reduced our data transfer cost. And the EKS, which is right now deployed on the Gravitron instances, it not only supports on the cost effective ways, but it also supports the environmental sustainability part. And also the CloudFront here, which is very effective in producing the output for the end user through UI. So it has helped us to easily scale our application to any region and serve the content to the user very effectively.
It's fascinating how this architecture addresses some key challenges in the agriculture sector, let it be a farmer or the stakeholders. I also like the way in which you leverage registry of open data to pick up only certain spectral bands of satellite data and also parallel execution of SageMaker jobs, which gave you the spatial and temporal scalability. Using the GIS plugin for PostgreSQL also helped, and I like the way you use CloudFront to improve user experience and reduce data transfer cost, and all of this in a cost-efficient manner. Thank you, Suryakant, for being here on the show.
Thank you.
Thank you all for watching This Is My Architecture.